Well, thank you so much. And you know, it is such a small world, because I was sitting on the couch with my husband a couple weeks ago, and I was trying to catch up on personal email, and in comes this LinkedIn connect from Ashley Bunce. So I'm like, oh, Ashley Bunce, who is the former executive director for Women in Defense, and a very young lady to be the executive director, I thought. So I thought, well, I'll open it up and see. And she asks if I wanted to speak. But, you know, my first question is, Bunce, do you happen to be related to Pete Bunce, who was at the Air Force Academy at the same time that my two best friends were 39 years ago, and that would be my husband, Doug, and my other best friend, Terry? And sure enough, Pete Bunce is her father. So what a small world. Of course, I had to say, yes, I'll come talk. And then, of course, Women in Defense is affiliated with NDIA, now led by the esteemed General Hawk Carlisle, whom I've known for 20-some years, and as he said, flew F-15Cs with my husband, and who we have just the utmost respect for. And he truly is the servant leader, so it is an honor to be here. And then the other connection of the small world is that I see on the schedule is the 24th Secretary of the Air Force, Heather Wilson, who happened to be my freshman college roommate. So, you know, I kind of see what's going on here. I'm the warm-up act for Heather. Now, really, you know, talking about that kind of leads me to be able to segue into life those many years ago when, in the third class of women to enter into the Air Force Academy, we had 1,600 cadets that were accepted in. There were 10% women. 4 years later, we had 65% of the class that graduated, and even less women who graduated. So of the 80-some women who graduated out of that class of 1982, 4.5% went on to become general officers. Brigadier General Lynn Sherlock, whose career was in mobility command, she flew heavies, and also worked in international affairs. And then we had Major General Barb Falconberry, who was a navigator and went into kind of doing some of the air education training command training business. And then we had Suzanne Vautrinot, who retired as a major general, who started off in space, moved into cyber, and now has her own consulting company and works in the, serves on several boards. The other two very active in nonprofit organizations. And then there's me. And then we have a whole host of others who went on to serve in great positions in academia, in the nonprofit sector, in the private sector, and in other sectors as well. And I tell you that because when we entered, none of us had a clue what we were going to do. There were no fighter pilots who were female. There were just then, at that time, some heavy pilots who were female. There were very few, you can count them on one hand, female general officers. And so from our perspective, the likelihood of any of us ever making general officer was slim to none. And in general, there just was a paucity of women who were serving in leadership positions anywhere in the United States. So when you think about how far we have come, things have changed. You see more women who are serving at the highest levels, certainly in the defense industry, but in other areas. And we kind of go in ebbs and flows. We gain ground, we sort of retrench a little bit. But that 5% number still exists in the senior leadership of most companies. I don't know why that is, but I'm hoping you all will be able to change that. And one of the things I love telling people is that you can't let your today define your tomorrow. Because when you look at who is in certain leadership positions, people want to move up and they want to be able to experience their career. They want to avail opportunities to themselves. A lot of people will not pursue opportunities because they think the field is limited, because they don't see that there are people like them who are in those senior positions. And I'll talk a little bit more about that when I use an example related to the Girl Scouts. I was sitting on a panel a couple weeks ago, and it was rather illuminating. But through all that, if you don't allow your today to define your tomorrow, you basically go in and you pursue your opportunities with open arms, you'll adhere to what I see as kind of the common thread of success no matter what you do, no matter if you're male or female, frankly, but certainly for those who, you know, as I talk to the young ladies who are trying to pursue their career. And number one is you persistently pursue opportunities that allow you to learn more about yourself that are very different, non-mainstream, because there is no single career path anymore that guarantees success. We see this, the changes that occur in the technology sector, in the industries that we come from, in the global landscape that we see unfolding before our eyes. And so you're basically charting your own course by what you find piques your interest. And I'll tell you also some of the things that don't necessarily pique your interests, such as some of those classes that you had to take that you didn't really want to take, and then you walked away from, and you learned quite a bit from that. So if you are pursuing those different opportunities, number one is you're learning more about yourself, and you're able to communicate, have a voice, to raise your hand, and to say, hey, I volunteer for those things, or hey, I'd like to be able to go try this thing. You learn about yourself, and you learn how to communicate what your druthers are at any particular point in time. You also need to learn how to ask questions. There are a lot of people. I don't mean to point out some of the guys that are in the room. Thanks for being in the room. But I know my husband abhors asking questions like getting directions. And I know that General Carlisle is a big Waiser guy. But very few people really like asking questions. You should ask all kinds of questions, because in the end, it doesn't make you look foolish. It allows you to kind of get other people to explain themselves, and it allows you to be able to integrate information in a way that you understand it. And so when you're asking the questions, you're asking questions to get more information for you to process the information so that you better understand things. And what I've learned by asking questions, because I ask a lot of questions, because I always seem like I pop into different jobs that I know nothing about, people wonder why I ask the questions. They think I know something, when in fact I know nothing, but I'm trying to learn something. And it works because it gives me the freedom to be able to ask those questions, to learn the information that I need. The third point is when you ask those questions and when you raise your hand to do different things, you're exposed to many different sources of information and experiences that you need to integrate. And that power of integration, your ability of taking the compendium of your experiences and the information allows you, and that whole processing, I mean, you're a human data processor, allows you to formulate and approach situations and issues very differently. Things that are uniquely you, not some cookie cutter role that people want to see. Nobody wants to lobotomize you. I mean, if you're in an organization seeking to socialize you, lobotomize you to a particular role, that's probably not a good thing. If you're in an organization that you feel is like Hotel California because you can't seem to move out to go do something else, that is also problematic. But if you follow those kind of tried and truisms by asking those questions, by pushing yourself to raise your hand, to volunteer for different things, you're going to gain a lot more experience and information that will help to make you more agile. It will help to diversify you, much like you would diversify an investment portfolio. It will give you those communication skills because it'll give you the confidence of asking those questions of others and of not feeling like, oh, nobody else is asking questions. My hope is that when you're in a room the next time and nobody's asking any questions, you can figure out what question to ask. And I just see Judy Fetter there, who's like a master question asker. So, hi, Judy. Judy and I sit on Dakowitz together, and we're always asking lots of questions. And I'm going to do a plug for Dakowitz, just like I'm going to do a plug for Women in Defense. Dakowitz is an organization, the Defense Advisory Committee for Women in the Services, and Judy and I are committee members on that. When I was a young officer and Dakowitz would come into town, I would run the other way. Because, you know, what is this organization, this Defense Advisory Committee on Women in the Services, who theoretically is trying to enable, you know, make things better for women to serve? I thought it was kind of, you know, who needs help, right? We do need help. And that is one of the things that I've noted in the my generation, I was going to say the more senior generation, but my generation of more seasoned individuals. When we came up into the world, it was all about gutting it out yourself. You did not want to look like you needed to rely on anybody. And Jackie, Dr. Jackie Hennessy, hello, ma'am. You know, you can relate to what I'm talking about. It was, can you stand on your own 2 feet, and can you do the job, and you don't want to have any assistance whatsoever. You can do it that way, but but I'm here to tell you, you do not need to do it that way. That is the beauty of Women in Defense and other organizations like that, that provide the support, allow you to collaborate together and learn from one another, that allow you to network, to learn about new opportunities, to help gain your skills. That is incredibly important. And that is something that I wish that I would have learned a long time ago, because I pretty much, it was grow up from the bootstraps, do it on your own, and make sure that you're independent and people don't know, like, you have other things going on in your life, like you have a family and you have children that you're raising. Most people didn't know that I had kids at home because I never put pictures up. Not that I was ashamed of my family, but it was just something that you didn't do, because otherwise people would say, that's a distractor. Oh, she's got kids, she's managing kids. She's like, her focus isn't gonna be completely there. I am so pleased to see, in recent years in the Pentagon, I had more young men that I mentored about work-life balance than women. I had young men who were putting up photos of their family. And then the women started putting up photos of their family. It took the guys doing that before the women felt comfortable doing that. And I would have, as the young men would come in and they would ask, how do I balance kind of work and family life? It was really not about them. It was about their spouse. Whether their spouse was stay at home or their spouse was career minded, they wanted their spouse to succeed in life and in career just like they were. That is the new generation. It is a generation that is actually looking to support one another, and I'm really pleased to see that. At the same time, I would tell, you know, I'd ask the officers who came in, and they were predominantly officers, why don't you talk to your boss about this? Your boss is married and has a family. And to a T, they'd say, they don't care. I don't think they care. I'd be embarrassed to ask. To which my response to fellow general officers is, what kind of culture are we creating when people feel embarrassed to ask questions about life and how to manage their life? They have the fortitude to ask the question, but they're afraid about the answer. And they don't want to be dimed out as people who are torn between things that matter, work, their career, and their life. And for women, in particular, that's kind of the hidden secret, is that work-life balance, you're torn between how do you succeed on all fronts? And my advice there is that only you can chart the course of finding that balance in your life. You can keep up with the Joneses, but don't. You're looking at what the Joneses are doing, but you know, it might be interested, it might be something you might want to do later on, but it doesn't have to be that you're replicating what the Joneses are doing. Everybody goes through different cycles in their life. Everybody sees what people are doing, but that doesn't necessarily mean that that is for you. And you are the ones who, I think today, we're much more respectful of people kind of laying their grounds when they're communicating those things, but you've got to speak up, which is the other point. Nobody can read your mind. I had a boss one time when my son was going to his last orchestra concert, and I went in to say, hey, this is the last orchestra concert, can I leave early? It was like 7 o'clock. And he said, absolutely, but what happened to the other ones? And I said, well, I just assumed that I needed to be here. And he goes, why didn't you ask? And I kind of did the, I didn't think you'd care. Which he said, shame on you. You have missed how many now? Because you didn't ask. So when we talk about communication, that is the power of the ask. It is the power of you taking control of your life and making your druthers known at different points, career points, along the way. And I told you I'd talk a little bit about the Girl Scouts. So the other week I was sitting on a panel, an industry panel at the Girl Scouts Council in the nation's capital. I'm on the board there. And you know, we had people from the aerospace and defense industry and Nestle, who apparently is moving from California to DC. That's pretty cool, because I like what they produce. But at any rate, we were talking about barriers to young girls, barriers to women in general. And you know, they really are focused on, at a young age, giving young girls the experience of teamwork, learning that they can lean on one another in order to accomplish things, learning how to explore, learning how to be an adventurer and a risk taker, but doing it as a team. And understanding that that support should follow them through educational career as well as to their mainstream career. But we were talking about how, at the same time, we had, I think it was Center for Creative Leadership produced this report that talked about how women bosses are actually much better at career development for both their male and their female workers, yet male and females prefer to work for a male boss. So on the one hand, you have females who do a great job. They learn how to be good leaders and career developers. And then you have the barriers. And the barriers are, why are there so few women at the top? And a lot of that is, the surmise that came out of that group was because of what we call sharp elbow syndrome. And that is, women only see a very few number of women who are in key leadership positions, and they think that that is the limit, that is the glass ceiling, and therefore they've got to edge one another out in order to get to that place. And we have got to stop that. Because ultimately, there is no glass ceiling. I was talking about when, you know, we were cadets at the academy, and there was, nobody had any expectations whatsoever. It goes back to the tried and truism of persistently pursuing those things that are of interest to you, that pique your interest, and excelling at it. But if you limit yourself to thinking that you've only got X amount of spots and you're going to elbow other people out, you do so at the demise of your peers who are females. You do so oftentimes at the demise of yourself, because people look at that and they don't see you as a team player. So that is another one in the rule book, is that you've got to be more inclusive of others to support and use Women in Defense and other organizations as a leverage point for you to be able to catapult one another to greatness. So then finally, I wanted to talk about a few caveats. I talked about the need for you to control kind of your career and to be able to communicate, raise your hand and ask those questions. I'd also just tell you, you know, I was mentioning about the pictures. I would like you to shamelessly plug your family. Because when you do that to other people, you remind them that there is balance in your life, that you have other priorities. I don't care if your family's your dog. My daughter has a puppy. I was just showing pictures. But it is so important for people to see that you have other priorities. And when you do that, particularly for those who have children, or in many of our cases, a parent that you're the primary caregiver for, you make people think about all the demands that people wrestle with in life. And in doing so, you also are that role model that you probably don't even know that you are, because somebody else, whether they're experiencing that now, that struggle, they're going to experience it later, and they're going to remember how you gracefully executed those responsibilities. So don't sell yourself short on that front. I know we've got Heather Wilson, who's waiting in the wings, so I don't want to take too much more time, but I do want to thank you for being the role models that you are, for taking stock, coming together, taking time out of your workday in order to be here, of being affiliated with Women in Defense and other organizations like that. And I hope that you walk away with a commitment not only to better yourself through some of those common threads that I talked about, but to make sure that you're mentoring others to be able to do the same. Because we're all about girl power and the guys who support us. Thank you.